I really felt that the whole Forever Planet Y story, you know, on previous Aerion albums, was really getting quite complicated in the end, and even for me. So yeah, I didn't want to alienate the listeners, and at some point I thought it was maybe a bit arrogant to assume that everyone knew what the hell I was talking about. So I wrapped up the story on 01 and on the track The Memory Remains on the Timeline album. And I left my beloved space and aliens behind, well, for now anyway. So yeah, this time I wanted to focus on real world situations here on Earth in this time. And because I love science and I love physics, this was a natural way to go. The story on this album looks at what happens when people are driven by an irresistible passion, like me in music, for instance. But in this case, it's a scientist who is obsessed with finding the theory of everything. This is the equation that will explain and tie together all known physical phenomena. He's so focused on solving the theory that he risks losing everything, including his family even. But he's not alone, because all of the characters are driven to fill some kind of emotional need, no matter what the consequences. And well, if I had to sum it up in one sentence, I would say that the story deals with the drive to succeed and the emotional costs that come with treading the fine line between genius and madness. The storytelling was also challenging, because I wanted to write a very, very clear story that everyone would understand. But writing lyrics that tell a clear story without being too simple or cheesy is actually really hard. I think successful examples are rock operas like Jesus Christ Superstar and, of course, Pink Floyd's The Wall, both huge influences on me. You have to find a balance between being lyrical and trying to move the story forward. But luckily, I got a lot of help again from Laurie, and we basically came up with this story together, talking about it for weeks and weeks. And when we had a basic story outline, I wrote the lyrics and she completely changed them. But for the better, of course. Also, this time I tried not to use so many rhymes in the lyrics. If you want to rhyme everything, you limit yourself in what you're trying to say, and you end up being forced into certain directions because, you know, it has to rhyme, damn it. And you would think that not having to find rhymes would make it easier, but it's actually really hard, and because you get so used to rhymes. I think it all started with a 10-minute track called Lost in a New Reel on my last solo album, which was built up of many, many little parts that somehow flowed into each other without following any rules, really. And I was really happy myself with how that turned out, and people seemed to like it, you know, they were very positive about it. So I thought, yeah, let's try further experiments in that direction. It was all written and recorded chronologically and spontaneously. So I guess that's how I ended up with four long epics this time of more than 20 minutes. There are also lots of tempo changes within the tracks themselves. It's something I haven't really done much in the past. A bit of a warning here, I suggest you do not listen to four epics in one go. You could die, so yeah, I think I should warn you here. Maybe take it easy, you know, one epic at a time, that will do. Many years ago, a Dutch guy called Sid Barnhorn, who is a film music composer, contacted me and he asked me if he could do some orchestrations for my music, which basically means that I send him all the MIDI information and he adds some great, huge orchestral sounds to it. So this time I had some parts that could definitely use his magic, and I sent them to him and I got them back, and he did a brilliant job. So after that I added some real violins, cello, flute to it, And he came here and together we mixed the whole thing and the result is amazing. So yeah, it's really the first time I did something like this. So thanks again, Sid. And to use your own words, it's epic. I think of the Belgian painter Jef Bertels as my own personal Roger Dean, or hypnosis if you like. Because he's been painting most Aerion front covers ever since the Electric Castle back in 98. And although this is like a completely new story, I still really wanted Jef to do the front cover painting again. And I think the fans also really want, and they even expect Jef, you know, with an Aerion release, because it fits so well to the music. And his beautiful painting this time represents the lighthouse where the prodigy finds the theory of everything. I think you could see the lighthouse as a metaphor for science lighting the way through the darkness of ignorance to the solid world of knowledge. Okay, I know I am an absolute control freak. I write almost everything, I record it, I mix it, I produce it, and I even master it. But this time a friend of mine from France, called Brett, asked me if he could master just one of my new songs. And he did, and damn, I hate to admit it, but you know, it sounded way better than the master that I did. So obviously I asked him to master the whole album, and he did, and he was also very, very involved in the whole pre-master process. So if you're looking for someone to master your album, look no further, you know, Brett at Tower Studios. Remember this one. So, merci mon ami. Et je sais que tu ne crois pas que je parle français, mais c'est pas de problème pour moi, hein? Alors ici est la preuve, hein? Thanks, man. Wow, that was good. Already as a kid, when I was small, I was small once. I didn't really like choruses, especially when they were repeated over and over again, you know, this commercial shit on the radio. You know, I like these long adventurous tracks like Kashmir or Stargazer, Bohemian Rhapsody, Stairway to Heaven, Thick as a Brick, 2112, Echoes. Okay, I'll stop. So yeah, this time I made an album with hardly any choruses at all. And hardly any lyrics being repeated over and over again, which I guess at first listen will probably come over as a lot of information, but which will, at least I hope so, stay interesting after repeated listens. So it might not be so clever in these really fast days of YouTube and stuff, but I followed my heart here, and I'm sure there are still people who wanna like sit down, relax, headphones on, and be taken on a musical adventure. So there you go. Here it is for you. God damn it, enjoy!
Aerion few years ago, it was actually in the backstage of our European festival. I don't remember exactly where. And we just started to talk about these things because he knew Lacuna Coil, he wanted to have me as a guest in one of his records, and I knew his music. So I definitely say, yeah, we gotta do something together, we gotta work together. But then for like multiple reasons, I was working with Lacuna Coil, I was probably leaving for another tour, because we tour a lot, and it was working. So because of a deadline or a lack of time, it didn't happen back then. Recently, he got my mail and he sent me a mail and just like, what do you think about doing something together now? And I was like, the timing is perfect because we're writing a new album with Lacuna Coil, but I also have some spare time so I could listen to the parts that I was supposed to sing. I had the chance to learn them and I had the chance to come to his studio to record them. So I'm really, really happy it happened. That it would have been a big challenge for me because when he asked me to sing on a new Aaron record, I knew that it would have been something different from what I usually do and sing. It would have been something more epic, more classic in a way, in a good way. And usually my singing is more rockish, it's kind of powerful and heavier. And I knew that I would have to sing something even more quieter and sweeter and more Celtic in some parts. And I immediately said yes, because I love challenges. And I was like, this is going to be a way for me to prove to myself that I can also do different things and I can be more, that I can not only sing in one way, but I can also experiment different things. So it was really important for me as a singer. Rob was really, really happy to do it, and I'm happy of what I did. Of course, I knew the project because there was a lot of buzz around it, also because of the guests. So there is a lot of mouth-to-mouth thing, you know, every time a new record comes out, there are always very good guests, very, very, very important guests from different type of music and different eras. And this is super cool, you know, putting together the old generation, the new generation, to do something completely new. I like that. Teamwork. I would describe it really relaxing, and this is extremely important because when you work with your band, you know that everything is going to be nice with a familiar atmosphere, but you never know up until you work with somebody else. So I think it's really important to click from the very first minute. And I know I knew him before, but to work with a person, it's something different. So when I met him at the airport, he smiled at me. I was happy to see him. I was really excited to work together, and he was excited too. So I immediately felt that great feeling of a friend coming to pick you up at the airport. And this is extremely important because you can give your best and not to feel stressed or worried, and you know that everything is going to be all right as it actually went. I always like to work with the producer of a record, and in this case also the songwriter, so it's even more important. I always like to work where they work because they feel more familiar with all the equipment and the mixer and all their stuff, and also because they can direct you in a way. When you work alone, you do your stuff and the stuff that you usually did, but when you have another person telling you, I'd like you to try this differently, I think it's a big lesson for you as a singer, because you can look up to your vocals from a different perspective, from the perspective of another person who's working with you, for you, because of course he wants the best for you as well to come out as a singer, as a good singer from the album. So I think it would have been different if I was recording at home. That's at least my point of view. He killed me with kindness. I mean, he's really, he's a really giant I mean, it's really tall. You can, but he's not intimidating. He's extremely kind, but at the same time, he's really precise. And I like that because I'm like that. When I'm in a studio, I really, really anal about things and every little particular. Everything has to be the way I want it. If not, I'm like, okay, let's do it one more time. Let's do it one more time. This wasn't good. And he's like me, so it was perfect to work with him. He didn't crap the whip too much. It was nice. I actually asked before because I wanted to know the story, because in especially in this type of music operas, there is a strong theatrical part. So you have to know your character, you know what you have to deliver. You want to know if in that part you're singing, you're gonna be pissed or mad or happy, because the singing is gonna be different. So I'm playing the part of the mother, very responsible toward the kid. And I'm married with this guy who is a crazy genius, and usually crazy and genius are going together. So my husband wants to find out the result about the theory of everything, and he gets really into it, forgetting his family, including me, and tries to get in this crazy project his own son, drugged him and trying to follow him in his craziness. And of course, I don't want that because I'm a mother. And so the story goes on. You know, I'm not mean, or at least I'm mean, but just because I'm a protective mother. So it was a cool character, because in reality, I'm not a mother, but I am a really protective person, even towards my friends or even towards the pets they have. So if I had a kid, probably I would be like, don't touch it, don't even come near him or her, or I kill you. I'm very protective. No, absolutely, absolutely. I never really did like very soft voices, or I didn't even know that I could get to very, very high notes. When I got the vocal line example in my mail, I was like, I'm never going to be able to do that. And that was another challenge. I was like, no, you know what? I'm going to do it. You know, I'll do my best. I'll go there and try to do it. And in the end, I did it. So that surprised me as well, because it's another goal that I feel I reached, and I know that I can get better if I want to. I have an example line sung by a guy, and this is very interesting, because a female voice is completely different from a guy one, but at least I knew which notes to follow. But we also worked in the studio, and we changed some parts that we liked better, or they were more suitable for my voice. So I kind of followed what I had to do, but I also had a little bit of freedom too. No, that's a good question, because I've never took singing lessons, so I don't really know how to warm up my voice. I started recently, and that means that I started in January, pretty much, on the American tour we did with Lacuna Coil, because we had to sing for 3 months straight, because the tour was that long. And Andrea, our singer, took some lessons, and he knew some exercises, so we warmed up together. And it really helps, because you can keep your voice healthier. But I'm really lazy, so all my parts, like, I just pretty much came into the studio without warming up, and I did them. I don't know what works better for me, if it works to warm up or to not to warm up. It really depends from the moment, from when I'm feeling it. And it's hard to describe. So I don't really know how you should warm up. My techniques, if I can call them so, is to sleep a lot, because rest is very, very important. I don't smoke. I'm not a big drinker. And I usually don't drink before I have to sing, because alcohol kind of affects my throat. And I drink a lot of tea. There was this tea called Throat Coat, so I drink that, or either warm water with honey works for me, as long as it's not too hot or cold, and drink a lot of water. Shit, a lot of water. I drink water all the time. And this is really important because it keeps your vocal cords hydrated, because you can't reach them with water, so you have to hydrate from the inside. So, but I don't know any techniques. No, he changed it because I didn't smell anything, and I have a very, very good nose about, you know, like smells and odors, and everything was super nice. So don't worry about that. If you have to sing with him, everything is gonna be all right. I don't have like one or two singers that really inspired me. I always loved to sing since when I was a little girl. I still have some recordings that my parents did where I was just like singing everything from kids song or even more adult songs. I just loved to sing, but I was very shy to perform. That's why I've never really dreamt about becoming a singer professionally. I've been listening to different type of music, so different singers. If I have to say who inspired me, I would say black vocalists, just because I like the fact that they are usually giving a lot of feelings in their singing. Most of the time, they're great singers, but they don't really care about their techniques. They care more about what they can communicate to the listener and to interpret what they're singing. And that's what I'm trying to reproduce. I'm not really interested in the technique or just to be the Mariah Carey in rock and metal. I don't care about that. I like better to be, you know, the Aretha Franklin of metal. That would be very pretentious. But I mean, if I have to aim to a direction, I will go to Aretha Franklin more than Mariah Carey. So I hope that's clear without saying I am the Aretha Franklin of metal, of course. But that's my goal, you know, to give feeling to whoever, to communicate my feelings to whoever is listening. Probably I would be the dragon, so it will be fire! Fire! I would destroy everything! No knights, no princesses. Everything destroyed because of me. No, but this is interesting because, I mean, it's the first time that I've been in Arjen's house, and he's more of a Star Trek fan, and I'm more of a Star Wars fan, but I still like the Star Trek stuff, so I'm starting to check, you know, oh, you have a Star Trek telephone. I have a lamp at home with the shape of a lightsaber. So I am the Jedi in this case, so he can do anything. He can do anything against me. I was like, this part that I just recorded is amazing. And he was like, well, yeah. I wish I would have taken more lessons, especially with an instrument, either keyboard or guitar would have been my favorite. But I know that it takes a lot of practice, and now I don't really have time to get to the point where you can say I'm really able to play guitar or to play keyboards. What I would say is that they really have to follow their heart, because they don't have to continue to something that it's clear that don't belong to them. You know, they really need to think what they really want and to want to become a musician because they really love to play, not because they want to be famous or they want to be rock star. They really have to love their instruments because there is a lot of commitment. So really believe in what you do and really love it. Well, yeah, that I'm probably more excited than them to hear the new record, because I heard the names of the other guests, and I can say anything for now, but I can't wait to hear the final result and to hear how different voices of people that never met before can come together and create something amazing and epic as it's gonna be. So I'm really, really, really excited, and you should be excited too.
inspired, I'd say. I felt good, and we tried a lot of different things, and it was such a huge amount of material. I think we had 32 separate pieces to record, but we just flew through them, and it was just a breeze. I mean, I had a session with my other band, Halo Bullets, a couple months earlier, and that was a struggle to get everything right, because I'm such a perfectionist, and almost to the point where I'm like, why am I doing this? Because I'm not enjoying this. You know, it's struggle, you know, and so I was really afraid that this would be the same kind of feeling, but it was exactly the opposite. So it was one of my favorite sessions, I think, with Arjen, and I think he'll agree, hopefully. I used to have a totally almost photographic memory when I used to work out really complicated songs for my first band, Elegy, or at least the first band that I recorded with. Every note was set. I had it in my head. I could see a picture almost mentally of the whole drum part, with every fill, every ride, ping, everything. I don't do that anymore. It may be because my brain just doesn't work like that anymore, but I don't have that kind of memory anymore for some reason. So, especially when I get a project like this and it's four songs that are 20 minutes long, I'm like, how am I gonna get that into my head? There's no way. So I just started listening to it over and over again, trying to find little spots that I can grab onto and say, okay, that is that part, and that happens before it, and that comes after. So that's how I sort of try to expand the grasp of the material. But I don't work out drum parts anymore. I save that for the studio. I try to have a vision of the song and not write every part beforehand. With Halo Bullets, I tend to program my own drums first, so I work out the arrangements, see what works within the song, and then I sort of memorize those, but then you start playing them and they come out different, so I change stuff. With this album especially, we worked out everything in the studio. A lot of the arrangements, I really have to play what's programmed, obviously, but other stuff we could just make up as we go along. So I found that putting energy into really working out the entire drum part in my head, I don't do it anymore. But I was glad when I got the version with guide vocals, because that put it into songs for me instead of just one long piece of music, which I was never going to be able to memorize. So when I got the guide vocals, I could say, oh, okay, so that is a song, and that is a song, and then there's an instrumental piece that I can go wild on, and then there's going to be a verse or a chorus or something. So that helped. No real method to prepare, but it works. It's a miracle that we get along as well as we do, actually, because it could go exactly the opposite way. It's butting heads, but we, you know, it's just one vision as such. That's really cool. We've been working together for so long, and we've done a lot of stuff together. And at one point, Arjen said, it's almost like I know telepathically what he wants to hear. He says, I'll be sitting there, and oh, I hope he's going to hit that crash, and somehow I do that. I mean, especially the first couple albums we did, it was, oh, Ed, could you try that? And I was like, oh, I wouldn't normally do that, but of course I'll try it. But now, instinctively, I know when I hear a riff, I know that he's going to want to hear that kind of drumming on it. So, and we like the same drummers, you know, so the reference point is very easy. You know, he only has to say Cozy. I'm like, yeah, sure, you know. So that helps. That's a good question, actually. I might be thinking I'm coming up with all this stuff myself, and he's just controlling me from a distance. The worst. I would hate myself if I was another person doing this to me as such, because I mean, the older I get, you would think it gets easier, or you're gonna get easier on yourself, but I just get worse and worse. I torture myself. I mean, I still enjoy doing it, obviously, otherwise I wouldn't do it anymore, but sometimes I think, Ed, loosen up on yourself a little bit. just the thought that I'm doing something and I'm have to let go at some point and put it out there, and everybody's going to listen to it and think, ah, he could have done better, you know. Like, so I listened to it like that myself. Oh, I could do better. I could do better. Okay, let's try it again. Do it again. So it's, yeah, I get more perfectionist the older I get. So, and having Pro Tools and seeing what you've played is very intimidating, because I can see exactly what I do wrong, you know, my faults as such, which make me me, because I'm not a drum machine. So obviously there's going to be, you know, I'm not all over the place, but sometimes you lose maybe intensity or tempo or something, which makes it sound natural and it's perfectly fine. But seeing it, you go, oh, that's a mess, you know. And then you hear it, it's everybody would think that's extremely tight and perfect. But so that has also changed my view on I'm not the spontaneous drummer that I was when I was 20, 22, going into the studio for the first time, doing an entire album in a day without click track or anything, just playing along, thinking, oh, that sounds good, you know. And now I take a few days and, you know, redo stuff. And so it's getting, I try to keep it more spontaneous again, because I had a period where I was just too focused on perfection, and now I think I have found a good balance between perfectionism on one side, but keeping it alive and spontaneous, and not planning every hit like I would do in the past, and maybe trying different stuff, and making it more fun. So, but yeah, perfectionist. Yeah. Look up perfectionist in the dictionary, it says C-ed, because it's insane level sometimes. It's complete, I think. I mean, obviously I can't do something that doesn't suit the song at all. And I might try something, but usually, you know, I won't have to say, ah, oh, that doesn't work, because I'll know. I can't say I'm a good drummer of myself, but, you know, I see myself more as an arranger. I have no problem playing a simple, straightforward beat if that is what the song needs, and I can also, you know, do flashy stuff when there's room for it. The one I used on this was my S-Class Pro, which I think I used before on Human Equation. It's a very simple kit and it's wood colored, so I don't take it out on stage, because it has to be black on stage, obviously. It's a very basic kit, a 22-inch kick, two toms, 10-12. It has small floor toms, 14-16. Cymbals are by Amedia, which I've also been playing on for a long time. It's a relatively small company. It's all handmade. I actually met the people that make the cymbals at the Music Messe in Frankfurt, and they're these proud Turkish people, and they make each cymbal with love. You can tell, and that's a nice thing. They're very musical sounding, they're not so loud, so you can really put them in the mix nicely without overpowering anything. You know, they have a few different series, and I use the heaviest, obviously, but they don't break. And that's a good thing, because I break cymbals like you wouldn't believe. I've broken hundreds of cymbals in all the years that I played. And these, you know, I break a few, maybe one or two a year, but the rest are still in one piece, which is very... I usually break them in the studio, because in the studio I really go for bashing them, and then they usually one breaks, one or two. But these are pretty resilient cymbals as well as sounding great, so it's a good choice for me. I don't really have much else to say. Drums, I hit them. This is gonna sound really arrogant, but I don't really have drummers that inspire me anymore. It's not to say that I don't see drummers and go, holy, wish I could do that. But in the old days, that sounds old. When I was younger, I would get that CD and I would put on my headphones and I would analyze everything that the guy is playing until I knew what was going on, could play it myself within certain limits. I don't do that anymore. I enjoy good drumming. but I don't think, oh, that's a cool feel, I have to try that, because I'm happy with where I am musically as a drummer, and I mean, I grow in a different way. I think I'm becoming a better band drummer, and maybe not as flashy as I used to be, although there's plenty of complicated stuff going on. The biggest inspiration on me was Dean Castagnuovo. When I first heard him play, I thought, holy, I have to, you know, get into this. What is he doing? He was doing stuff that I would never think of on a drum kit. Just the way he... Okay, can we start again? Dean Castagnuovo, yes. Just the way he used toms and kicks to do fills. I would think a fill was something you did with your hands, not with your feet. And that really changed my entire way of thinking when it comes to drumming. But that was the last real big inspiration that I had. Musically, I get inspired a lot, but not specifically by certain drummers. Making timeless music. Because it really is. I mean, Electric Castle was done when, 97, 98, I think. And people still say, oh, love that album. And I think that's cool. It was made a while ago by now, you know. So, and I think it'll be an album that people listen to in 10 years or maybe 20 years still. So that's the best thing. Maybe what I took away from drummers that I started listening to and decided to pick up drumsticks, hopefully. I saw a YouTube video of a kid, a 14-year-old kid, playing my parts. I thought, wow, that's so cool, you know. I mean, and that reminds me of me when sitting in my room and I didn't even have a decent drum kit. I had a very small drum kit. I was just working out what to do, and it had one cymbal, and I broke it. I totally trashed that kit, and then my dad gave me a decent drum kit, and that's when I really started getting into it for real, listening to all these drummers and watching videos, and oh, how are they doing? Okay, so I should cross my hands. Ah, okay, that makes sense, you know. So, yeah, hopefully I inspire people to drum, pick up sticks and do some crazy stuff, and hit hard and not use triggers, and that's granddad speaking. It's a stick and then a chain and then a ball with spikes. That looks like a fabulous weapon. In Dutch it's called goeiedag, which is sort of like hello, you know, and wow, I mean, I'm not a violent person at all, don't get me wrong, but whacking somebody once with that in sort of a parallel universe where that person would just get up and walk away, yeah, I mean. Proud. I'm still, after all these years, I mean, nowadays I think, oh, of course I'm going to play on the new Aryan, but, you know, I have to take a step back sometimes and think, that's pretty special that I'm part of something that so many people revere, worship almost, and I'm just part of that, you know. Okay, that's stupid goosebumps here. It's very special to be a part of something big, because it's a big thing. I mean, if you look at it, it's just me and him in the studio doing drums, but it's such a huge universe almost to be part of, so that's pretty proud of that, you could say. Yes. I should hope not.
I don't know. talked, I think it was around in 2010 or maybe even 2009, and he approached me, and the thing was that we had a new record label, and they were, you know, we were going to really put a lot of time into the new Grand Magus album, Harbor on the North, and so I wasn't able to do it back then. But then he contacted me again for this new Aryan album, and we just agreed to do it. Well, I talked to him on the phone, and somehow things didn't go as planned for me, so I guess he did something, I don't know what. He's obviously a Jedi of some sort. When I started talking to Aryan, I realized that he was responsible for one of my favorite metal tracks ever, called Black Star Rising, on an album with Bodine. I think I must have been around 11 or 12 maybe, and I was listening to this rock show on Swedish radio. I had like a ghetto blaster, you know, with radio and the cassette player, and I didn't understand that I could just record, press record on the tape deck to record from the radio. So I had another radio in front of the tape recorder, and while I was, you know, sitting with a pencil, you know, doing the drum rhythm or whatever, so it all came into the tape. So my version of the Bodine song is, well, it's been altered, let's say that. I've listened to that song so many times that I was really intrigued about, you know, the possibility to work with him. And I'm no expert on the Aryan stuff, but it seemed to me like a real challenge for me, so I couldn't really, you know, I couldn't hesitate about this. Well, I play the teacher, and he seems to me to be a guy that, you know, a very talented person that maybe didn't fulfill his goals, and he wants to have this prodigy kind of act as an agent for him to fulfill his dreams and his dreams of, you know, recognition and glory and things like this. So in one sense, he's very human, you know, and at the same time, he's got this, as I feel, pretty dark side to him, you know, that he feels maybe that he didn't get the chances that he was supposed to, but now he has a chance to fulfill this through the youngster, you know. One of the cool things when I got to see the lyrics and things for this was that it didn't really have a black and white thing or separated into good or evil, which is something that I believe in personally, you know, with where I come from in, you know, the Norse tradition there are no evil or good characters. All characters and all gods and all people have both, you know, the mischievous and the kind of kind side to them, you know. And I feel that it's a very good representation of how things work in reality, you know. I had a lot of fun. It was definitely a challenge, you know. This is something completely different from what I normally do, and I'm not used to singing someone else's, you know, melodies or lyrics. But it was great to work with Aryan, and he was really supportive, and we had a lot of fun doing the stuff, even though it was hard, you know. But I really enjoyed it, and I learned a lot. I think for me that the hardest thing is that I'm really used to basically two kind of rhythms, either a simple 4-4 or a 6-8 kind of shuffle you know, beat, Manowar feel. And for this type of music, there are a lot of different time signatures and stuff. And so for me, it was really a challenge to understand where I was supposed to start singing and stop singing and things like that. But I think after a while, you get a feel for it. And for me, not being, you know, like a, you know, a pro singer, I have to like feel it in my body to be able to do it properly. So it takes a while, you know. Well, I got the impression that mainly, I mean, as much as I wanted, but at the same time, there would be no point in doing something that wasn't intended from the start. So I think my contribution, you know, is mainly the voice and, you know, certain kind of inflections and things that are, you know, my kind of thing. But I didn't go in and change anything per se, you know, because this is like a one man's vision, you know, and you have to respect that. And I don't think that there was anything that I wanted to change either, so. My biggest challenge is that I'm not a technical singer at all. You know, I probably use a lot more power than I need to. When it's like straining vocal parts, I should probably use another technique than I do, but you know, I try to relax and I try different approaches to do what I'm supposed to do, and at least, you know, 1 out of 10 times it works, you know. I have pretty high demands on myself, and I always want to get better. It's not something that I have to kind of fight to get. I mean, I have to fight to get better, but I don't have to fight to get the urge to get better. So I always want to improve, and there are always things that I'm not pleased with, both, you know, guitar playing wise and also singing wise. So, you know, and also if you're happy about everything you do, there's not much point in doing, you know, new music, because you've already reached your goal. So what's next, you know? I've never felt that I've reached my ultimate goal, you know? So I have to keep on doing it.
Can I ask what your ultimate goal actually is?
Well, I think my ultimate goal would be to just, I don't know, to sing like Eric Adams. I'm never going to reach that, but you know, something like that. You know, the only advice, and it's such an old advice that I've heard from many people, is that you have to stay true to your own vision, and there is no way you can kind of tailgate on something that is popular. So you just have to stick to your guns, and if you persevere and are ambitious enough, then there is a chance. But if you try to do something that is not really in your heart, then it's never going to work. So no matter how outdated or unpopular the stuff you like is at the time, you have to stick to it, if you believe it. Sorry, I don't. I mean, this is also probably something I should learn. But I think probably if you have really, really good technique, you don't have to warm up. I've read stuff about Dio, for instance, that he never warmed up. He just did it because his technique was so intuitive that he didn't need to warm up at all. I would choose between either a sword, you know, a two-handed sword, or an axe, I think. But I would go for the sword in the end, I think. It's more versatile, you know. I didn't really notice any bad smells. Probably the most bad-smelling person on this album is going to be me anyway, so. Best thing was that it was a lot of fun, and it was really rewarding for me in the end to do something that I really didn't think that I could pull off. Yeah. Well, hopefully they will feel that this is something a bit different than they might be used to, and that it's a voice that they maybe didn't expect for this kind of music, and hopefully they'll like it, you know.
I think it was around 2008 or something like that, that I was touring US with Nightwish, and at this one place there was this one couple where the guy actually came over and asked me if I had heard about Arjen and his project. And yeah, I had. I actually had my friend had given me the Universal Migrator double CD. I had to listen to it and liked it a lot, especially the prog side and all that. And he said that he's got an email to Arjen and said that he might be interested in contacting me. And I don't really remember how much we talked about that thing. But anyway, I got the email when I got back home from touring. I sent him an email that I heard that you might be interested in doing some things together or something like that. And he said, yeah, that he had some projects going on already at the time where all the vocalists had been booked and all that, but in the future. And we've sent some emails now and then afterwards, and now this whole thing then just happened. That he asked if I would be able and if I would have the time to do a few vocals for the upcoming album. And I said, I got time, let's do it. No, I was willing. because I really like the albums. Like I said, I got the Universal Migrator, I got Human Equation, I got the one with the digital gold, O's and ones and all that. And I got these myself. I've been listening to them a lot. I'm a big fan of progressive rock and heavy metal and things that overlap. These areas are an interest to me, and I've enjoyed the albums before, so yeah, why the hell not? I really enjoyed the duet Annika and Jorn Lande did on Comatose, which isn't that much of a metal, but I really like the atmosphere on that song. Might be my favorite, yeah. Pretty comfortable, actually, because, well, he's got the same kind of a small studio setup, which I pretty much have. Of course, all the equipment isn't the same, but still, it's kind of a small, intimate, but nice, dry sound and everything. And we seem to agree pretty much on how to do certain things and when to go low, when to go high, what kind of melodies, what is the necessary, you know, amount of acting compared to the lyrics and all that. So far it's been really easy. And we've been agreeing with a lot of things, when to do things again, and when we're satisfied with things and all that. I got no problem. Seems to me I have pretty much. I mean, we have been concentrating on getting the melodies down pretty much as they were intended. But yeah, with the little things you put there to be comfortable as yourself are there. And I've been able to insert them in and also have figured out a few melody lines and put them down a little bit differently from the original ideas, just in order to get the most, you know, comfortable things and convincing things out of what I do. And that is a good thing. as a guy who comes from heavy metal surroundings, the biggest challenge is that, of course, I'm always expected to go really high and loud, and so sometimes that can be pretty, you know, it can wear you down. But anyway, in this case, we've been able to use quite a lot of different signs. Use the low, use the soft, use the hard, use the high, and all that. And that is a good thing because, well, yeah, in a lot of ways, I am a prisoner. I'm in the box with the bands that I'm usually with. And there are certain things you're always expected to do and what you do and all that. And this time around, we've been able to use the whole scale of things, which is really nice to me. I like that thing. If I'm with Nightwish or Tarot, then I'm pretty much responsible of what my output is. So I have to make these decisions. I have to make them, or I have to be responsible for those a lot. And this time around, I can insert those little things and ideas which I like to do and all that. But in the final result, I can pretty much be laid back and trust Arjen's vision about how he wants the things to be. And in that way, it's been very relaxing to do this thing, because he's ultimately responsible for what his album is going to be and what he likes and what he doesn't like. So I can just concentrate on performing well as I can be, which sometimes isn't that much. It's an over-ambitious, maybe an overconfident egoist, and slightly on the wrong side, which is of course something that I'm totally good with. Taking that kind of approach, I mean,
you're fine with walking the dark side.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, yeah. I think Darth Vader was way more impressive than Luke Skywalker, for instance. But you know, I'm a relaxed middle-aged family father, so this is how I get to have some output for these dark thoughts that I have. Okay, I don't really do all this la 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 stuff. I'm too lazy for it, and I'm too lazy to warm up for half an hour. So I usually start singing quite immediately when I get to studio and let it open up by singing. I use this kind of a vocal burn technique a little bit just to get the muscles loosened, which really sounds like this. And you do it from there, from low, and squeeze it up a bit, and do it for some minutes, and okay, feels like I can sing, and that's it. Ronnie James Dio and Richie Blackmore were pretty much responsible for that thing, for writing quite a lot of songs on the album Long Live Rock and Roll. When I heard Kill the King, I was 11, and I really pestered my father with my brother that we gotta have this album. Finally, he gave in, bought it for us. Then I was listening to it all the time, learned all the lyrics. So I was singing the songs in the, you know, backyard swing. The neighbor's kids thought I was crazy, screaming my head off. And within a couple of years, I was in my first school band, playing guitar and singing. And in hindsight, I think there was a definite connection. Well, a lot of other influences as well, pretty much from the same way, like Rob Halford, for instance. There's something a bit different might be like Ian Anderson from Jethro Tull. Yeah, I've been listening to, you know, also kind of a female vocalist like Kate Bush and things like that also, which they've all had a certain impact on me, how to do things. I think by the time I was 15, I already knew that there's still no turning back, that I would go for it. And luckily my parents, even though they knew that this is an insecure and chaotic thing that the boy is trying to achieve, they let me try it, and I tried for a long time, never gave up. I still haven't woken to think of that, think it like that. I mean, they call you a professional, they call you a musician or something like that. I'm a guy who likes to put up and be a part of a rock and roll show, likes to do albums, likes to do songs, likes to play and all that. But I've never really thought of myself as a musician, or far be it from me, for like a virtuoso or anything like that. I play as well as I can, and I sing as well as I can, and at its best, I've been able to move a lot of people with that. And it's a privilege. It's a gift I got from the universe, and I'm really happy I did. Because I still enjoy making impressions by doing music, by playing, by singing and all that. And of course, you always, as a songwriter, a lyric writer, player, you always want to find new things, for not to go by the recipe. You've got to find new add-ons for that. You go by your basic Western musical scales and all that. You got to find things to put in chords, the different tones, colors, atmospheres and all that. And to renew yourself in some ways, in order not to, for the things to get stale. And there are still times when I feel like you get goosebumps from hearing certain things and all that. Of course, it's way more rare than what it was when I was a teenager, being a fan of certain bands and all that. But it still happens, and that's a good thing. That's spurring you on. I have to think about that. Medieval battle. Yeah, I'd like to be up there on the hill with a, for instance, bow and a good bunch of arrows. The melee isn't really something that I would probably enjoy. I would have to be gradually inserted into that. So yeah, bow and the arrows, yeah, to do. Anyway, I've been playing a lot of role-playing games with the computers and all that, so I do like to sneak and snipe. It's a bit evil, I know, but I like it. He won't beat me, not without a fight.
No! Okay. Hey, let's do high five. High five. Come on.
Ian came to me in a dream when I was living in Melbourne.
In one of his mails, he said that he had this weird dream about me.
In the dream, he sent a few of his muscle men to my house and took me on a plane and flew me to the Netherlands. And I was transported through these underwater tunnels to his island. And I was told under strict instructions that I had to wear some goggles that would distort my vision. And I was not allowed to look at Ian at all.
I'm gonna meet him like this. I have no idea if he's gonna get the joke or if he even remembers the dream. Oh, what do you least think? Oh, Ian, now it's better. That looks a lot better. A little fluffier there.
Oh. Then I woke up from the dream the next day, and there was a message in my Facebook inbox saying that he'd read a review of my stuff in a Dutch magazine and was keen to check out some more. And so that was pretty mind-blowing in itself. And then he said, would you be interested in singing on my next album? And it sort of blew my mind a lot, actually, because, you know, I was an admirer of his stuff for quite some time. And then he said, it will probably be an Arian album. And then I was like, holy crap, you know. So yeah, it blew my mind. My first initial response, short answer, it blew my mind.
The two albums that I am familiar with the most are The Human Equation and the Zero One album, the last album. But I'm useless with song titles. All right, so I can't. I remember things as riffs, you know, and I remember certain parts of songs, but I think his work for me just keeps getting better and better. So I'm really looking forward to hearing this theory of everything as an entire work, because I haven't heard it like that yet. the first thing I kind of realized was that he's super nice. I mean, I kind of got the impression from watching videos and so forth with him that he was a cool guy anyway, but it was just instantly so comfortable, so accommodating, he's very, very much interested in my opinions on the performances as well, which, you know, initially I thought I'll just do as much as I can and he can say I love this, hate this, hate that, you know, whatever. But he was interested to see my feedback as well, which was really cool. Well, Arjun sent me the demos a few months ago, and I've been just listening to them and singing along and trying, experimenting different ways to approach the melodies. You sort of step into this assuming the character. I play the father in the story, and so there's a little bit of ambiguity as to whether he's evil or his intentions are pure, or you know, so as far as that, there's already a certain fulfillment that needs to be fulfilled. But I feel completely free to try and put my own spin on the parts. It's all about what works between us and obviously what works best for the music and for the song and for the character, for the story. We record things in segments, so like making a film, we don't record the album from start to finish. We sort of work on sections. So the one thing you need to get used to is where you're up to in the story. What's happening with the character here? What's he going through? What's going through his mind and so forth? So that's one thing. And then often we'll do multiple takes of the same portion of the song, just to try to get the right mixture of emotion and timing and pitch and things like that, and just to try to keep the options open. I was warned about that, and it was washed and cleaned, but I made sure you'll have to wash and clean it again. He'd make me sing the same thing 5, 6, 10 times. We had it in the first take, so he's an extreme perfectionist. No, I'm just joking. He's great. It's great. Maybe 4 or 5 tops. I really need sort of feedback from him. If something's great, he tells me it's great. If it's not so great, tells me it's not so good. And which is perfect, you know. It's exactly the way I kind of need to work. Really? I actually don't get that from him at all. I get from him a man who has a clear vision of what he wants from his singers and from his artists. But see, I associate a control freak with someone who will stamp out someone else's idea for their own, just for the sake of it, for claim of ownership or something, like, this is my idea and I don't want any other external points of view. He's not like that at all. He's very open to suggestions and open to different interpretations, so I don't think that's a fair description of him at all.
Yeah, I think I have a strong lower range, and I think I have a strong upper range, but it's this in-between section that I have a lot of trouble pronouncing certain vowel sounds. I want to be very sure. It's very important to me that everything I sing is clear and understandable. So that was probably the biggest challenge, is making sure that I wasn't piking out on a lot of these closed vowel sounds, because it's easier to sing with an open vowel sound. So that's the biggest challenge for me at the moment, is making sure that I'm in tune with these tougher vowels. An E sound is tougher to see. There's a certain point in my voice where it's much easier to just to open it out. It's more even in terms of pitch, but it's not the correct sound for the word. Ah, all are all easier. They're all, you know, you can just picture an open ah mouth, you know. Look like a damn idiot. Yeah, I think if you know what you're doing is right, and it's important to you, and it feels right, then nothing that anybody else says or nothing that anybody else does should matter. Don't allow yourself to be misguided in any way. Try to look into yourself, and that's all the validation that you need. Morningstar, definitely Morningstar. You know, the swinging big, with the big ball with the things on it. Yeah, Morningstar all the way, because it's got range, it's got power, and it's the most metal looking weapon you could think of. Morningstar all the way. My favourite warm-up technique is the proper cup of coffee exercise. I don't know if you hear this, I'll demonstrate now. So.
A proper cup of coffee in a proper coffee
right.
cup. A proper cup of coffee in a proper coffee cup. A proper cup of coffee in a proper coffee cup. A proper cup of coffee in a proper coffee cup. Should I keep going? A proper cup of coffee in a proper coffee cup.
I think I like it the most because it reminds me of coffee. That's it.
I'm so close to the answer. A dazzling symphony of cosmic stream. What are you tormenting? Are you jealous? There must be a reason.
I think that's cool. I mean, I'm not famous. I barely known in the world. I have my little group of fans, which I I thank and say hi. It's huge for me. I'm no one. I'm nobody. I sing in a little band. We put in it as much love and strength and work as we can, but we're still so less known band, so it came almost as a shock. He really want me. So, because I have seen that Ariane have worked with so many big names, and even if my name goes on a booklet written behind those names, it's really good. He asked me to sing a piece of a song of one of his albums to see how my voice was. So I don't have anything to record, just my phone. And he said, oh, it's all right, you know. So I went in my basement, my famous basement, and I recorded me singing it live with my phone.
You really recorded that on your phone?
Yes. So the song was awful, but at least, you know, there was no auto-tune in it. It was just what you get is what you what you hear. I don't know, he says something like he had goosebumps all over, and it was so flattering. Yeah, it's good. You know that you can raise an emotions in someone who wrote the thing. It's been very good. I had fun. His kind is not afraid to ask you to do the things the way he wants. He's also willing to accept your kind, your point of view, and that's very good. It's a girl, obviously, and she's a good character, but maybe if I didn't get it wrong, she does something she regrets. When I record with my bands, I need to stay within certain constraints, because I have to do power metal and sing what power metal fans expect me to sing. But here I was a little bit freer, and the kind of music was more different, and I liked it. I had to use my different voices and a lot of expression. And it was the same, because it's always a tense moment. You have to do what you know you can do, but every time it's like you're, can I do it? Mm-hmm. And it's always a discovery for me, for myself. So it's challenging every time, and it's very, I love recording. It's a power metal band, so there's a certain kind of style in which you have to be in. You can go all poppy, and I'm actually a pop singer. I love Celine Dion and Whitney Houston. I just love virtuosos, vocalists, and I can do that. I just have to be powerful and straight. Instead, I'm someone who likes to feel the space between the lines, and which I was able to do today, and was very, very good. I feel way much more tension in the studio, because you get recorded, and whatever you do, it's like that. It stays. When you sing live, I don't feel, I don't panic in front of people. I've been singing live since I was 4 years old in front of people, so I feel comfortable. And even if you make little mistakes, it just get lost in the whole performance, so it's fine. I love it. It's something that I've been doing since forever, so I don't know where it started. It just grew with me, and now I'm here. I think it's different from a real musician than me. I'm just a singer. I've studied piano, but I know so little about music that I don't feel like I can give any advice to a real musician who plays instruments. You just need to study and really be humble. The thing is this, be humble and keep on studying, and if your passion is strong, you can do whatever you want. No, actually, I never get too close, because I always sing so loud that I have to stay away from the mic. But no, it wasn't stinking. I had worse maybe with things stuck in the middle. It was pretty clean. Oh! So, vocal warm-ups are the silliest things to do. I usually go with a normal... Okay, maybe done better. Or when I have to... loosen up a bit here. This thing that looks so awkward. Mm-hmm. all around and around and until it hurts here. But if you push your tongue and round and round and round, but it really loosens it and enlarges, so the air comes through. You can use your voice better. Mostly, yeah, like that. Oh, for the fans, I hope they like, of course, the whole album, and they're not too, they're not ashamed that I'm in it, and I'm not, oh, I don't know how to say it, that they're not disappointed that I'm not a big name in the music, but I try to do my best, and I hope they appreciate it.
But it can't reach me. It all seems so trivial in the scheme of things.
He emailed me after, I think, years and years of having heard about my band. That was before I joined Camelot, so that was during the Seventh Wonder time, I think he heard about me. And then when I joined Camelot, I think he checked me out. He emailed me and I instantly wanted to work with him because I already knew some albums that he made. So of course I said yes, and here we are. The honest thing is, I was super happy. Really happy, because that's one of the biggest things, actually, at least you can do, like to be asked to join like an all-star project or whatever, like so and also that it was him, because I also already listened to some of his albums and I really enjoyed it. So the first thing was, of course, sheer happiness. My favorite would be 01, because that, I think that was the first album I listened to from Arjen. I play the part of the prodigy, which is kind of close to my own way of dealing with things in a way. I mean, I never studied music or I never studied like that, but so it's what people consider to be my talent, I already have. You know, I didn't train myself to do it, so I could relate to that a little bit. But yeah, it was a lot of cool parts, and I get to show off different sides that I don't maybe show off in my other bands, so it's cool. Experience in the studio was great. I mean, I came here, I had no expectations whatsoever, because usually when I record for a longer period of time, and I often do it myself. And this is quite different, to work with a producer, already pre-written stuff. So I didn't really knew what to expect, but it turned out really cool, and Arjen is great to work with, and super nice guy and talented, so I guess you'll hear. The end result was really cool. I would say a lot of creative freedom. The parts were already pre-written, so I kind of knew the parts already, but then everything was like, if you have something better, so it's kind of no prestige there. I mean, it's just, if you have something better, let's do this a great album. Let's make this the best we can. So we worked out some cool parts together. Not very hard. No, I think he relies on me wanting to do a good job also. I mean, of course, if he's not happy, he will tell me and we will work things out. But I also have I have high standards when it comes to my singing. So I won't just leave it with half. You know, if I don't like it, I'm gonna try it until I actually like it. So in this case, he hasn't been so hard on me. But I think he can be if he really don't like anything. I think he really tells you, and then you have to find a solution. I really think that my sense of I want to be perfect. I don't know how if there's a word for it, but perfectionality. Perfectionism. That mechanism is the most important thing for me, because I never want to be any worse than I already did. So I always try to improve. Even if it's singing or exercising, or I think that's one thing that you have or you don't have. But I don't settle with just good. I want to be the best or even better, you know. So that's why I think I evolve as a musician as well. Very hard on myself. So at times when I don't get it right, I'd be very angry at myself, and I won't stop until I get it right. Well, it's not going to be any demonstration, but I usually, before tours and recording sessions, I usually try to sing a lot, like gradually sing more and more during maybe a month or 2 months. It's like practicing with weights or do running or whatever. You have to gradually, if you didn't do it for a long time, you need to gradually do more and more to make the body get used to what you're going to do. So that's basically all I'm doing. And also it's very important to drink water and to rest. But mostly I think it's the preparations in terms of singing more and more. Just do what you feel is right. I mean, do what you like, and don't try to copy anyone. Just be yourself in your own musicality, and explore that as long as you can, or as much as you can. And that way, you will find your own identity within the music, which you can use instead of doing something that other people already did. What I think is important when it comes to being a musician, if you want to succeed, is to never give up. Because there's so many people giving up, like they think things gonna happen right away. But that's not the way it happens for most of the people. I mean, you have to work a lot of years, work hard and never give up, and believe in yourself, then you're going to succeed. Well, I always aim for feeling instead of, I want to provide the listener with an experience, like they can experience what I'm singing, maybe rather than just a technical thing of singing. You know, I want to express a feeling with a nice melody and the way I sing, rather than just sing high notes or whatever. You know, I think that's the most important, what I look for when I listen to music. I want to feel something when I listen to music. If I don't, I'm going to turn it off. Well, I'm not so sure about before me, but after me, he will probably change it.
But was it stinky?
No, it wasn't stinky. It smelled like man and woman combined.
Oh.
but it wasn't stinky.
That could actually be kind of naughty. If you were transported back to a medieval battle, what would be your weapon of choice? I don't make these up.
This could also be naughty, but my tongue.
Please explain.
I'll try to not fight and do some kind of talking to not fight, probably. Ease myself out of the situation.
It's really been an adventure, and yeah, this is a true prog album, you know, in every sense of the word. Already as a kid, when I was small once, it's true. I like these long adventurous tracks like Kashmir or Stargazer, Bohemian Rhapsody, Stairway to Heaven, Thick as a Brick, 2112, Echoes. Okay, I'll stop. So yeah, this time I made an album with hardly any choruses at all and hardly any lyrics being repeated over and over again. Which I guess at first listen will probably come over as a lot of information. Now, maybe that's not so clever in these fast days of YouTube, but I followed my heart here. And I'm sure there are still people who wanna like sit down, relax, headphones on, and be taken on a musical adventure. In the past, I used to first record everything on a little cassette player. And then after a few months, I would have like 50 ideas, pick out the best ones, put them in my computer, order them, start recording. This time it was different. I just entered the studio, started recording spontaneously. So every idea I had just led to the next idea. It was all written and recorded chronologically and spontaneously. So I guess that's how I ended up with four long epics this time of more than 20 minutes. Arion basically only has two permanent members, obviously me. And of course then there's add-on drums. This was a very smooth session, it's only getting better. And this time, you know, after all these years we worked together, he still manages to surprise me.
We've had good sessions before, but I think this one was inspired, I'd say. I felt good, and we tried a lot of different things, and it was such a huge amount of material.
We recorded a double CD's worth of drumming in just 3 days, you know.
I think we had 32 separate pieces to record, but we just flew through them, and it was just a breeze.
Piece of cake. I originally programmed the drums myself, here in my own studio, and then sent them to Ed.
A lot of the arrangements where I really have to play what's programmed, obviously, but other stuff we could just make up as we go along.
I don't work out drum parts anymore. I save that for the studio. With this album especially, we worked out everything in the studio.
I basically don't have to tell Ed anything when he's drumming, you know? Even when I do explain him what I want in my weird drummer's language, he miraculously gets it.
I used to have a totally almost photographic memory when I used to work out really complicated songs. Every note was set. I had it in my head. I could see a picture almost mentally of the whole drum part. I don't have that kind of memory anymore, especially when I get a project like this and it's four songs that are 20 minutes long. Like, how am I gonna get that into my head?
Acht millimeter nog maar.
Well, he was asking, you didn't know where it was, because it's like a 9/8, 9/8, weird time signature in Prague. And he asked me, how much longer? I don't know. And I was like, 2 centimeters. The cool thing about Ed is that he really listens to what's happening in the song. You could say he's a very musical drummer. Of course, a lot of the stuff that Ed does is very technical and very difficult, but he always adds something to the music.
We've been working together for so long and we've done a lot of stuff together. At one point Arjen said, it's almost like I know telepathically what he wants to hear. He says, I'll be sitting there and, oh, I hope he's gonna hit that crash, and somehow I do that.
Gaaf, notice the g, like clearing your throat, beware of the person in front of you. Gaaf is a Dutch word and it means something like flawless. And apparently I use it a lot. And especially when Ed is playing the drums.
Ja, heel gaaf. Ja, ik vind het wel gaaf. Lijkt me wel gaaf. Gaaf hoor. Gaaf. Maar dit vind ik wel gaaf. Ja, gaaf patroontje. Veel vond ik ook gaaf. Gaaf hoor. Gaaf hoor, hé. Gaaf hoor. Ja, gaaf om die mee te spelen. Zou iets het gaaf hoor? Dat is wel gaaf hoor. Ja, super gaaf.
Ed Sprouse. Allemaal gaaf. Allemaal gaaf. Yeah.
Bijna.
Bijna.
Het is also me. Bijna gaaf.
Bijna. Almost.
Ed is quite hard on himself in the studio and possibly even a bigger perfectionist than I am. If that's at all possible. When we're all freaking out about a perfect drum fill he just did, you know, like, and we're all like, oh, damn, that was great. We look into the studio and then he sits there like, no, again.
I'm such a perfectionist and almost to the point where I'm like, why am I doing this? I torture myself. I mean, I still enjoy doing it, obviously, otherwise I wouldn't do it anymore. But sometimes I think, Ed, loosen up on yourself a little bit. I try to keep it more spontaneous again, because I had a period where I was just too focused on perfection. And now I think I have found a good balance between perfectionism on one side, but keeping it alive and spontaneous, and maybe trying different stuff, making it more fun. But yeah, perfectionist. Look up perfectionist in the dictionary, it says see Ed, it's insane level sometimes. Hey!
it's very important for me that all the musicians I work with, that they actually enjoy my music. And this also goes for the classical musicians. Maaike already played cello on my solo album, and she did like a great job, and I really liked working with her, so I asked her again for this Arion album. And she's very much into the music, which is very important for me. And we always have a lot of fun, you know, fits of laughter, and the result is great. And now, on one leg, please. My friend Jeroen has played wind instruments now on all my albums ever since Human Equation. You know, it's funny, I always tell him, sorry man, this time I have just two or three parts for you. And then, you know, nevertheless, he fills up his car with all these weird instruments. This time he even unearthed what I disrespectfully call the monster flute. Sorry Jeroen, he hates it when I call it that. But it is a monster flute, it's like even bigger than I am, which is saying something.
Yes, sir.
High five! High five. Yeah!
Yeah!
Ben, whom I worked with loads of times now, he's an amazing violinist, I keep saying it. He actually enjoys my music. I mean, I think that's why he contacted me in the first place. And therefore he really understands what I want. I never have to worry whether his timing or his tuning is correct. I think he has absolute hearing, which is amazing. And that's a luxury position, you know, because you got something good and you can make it even greater. About 5 years ago, I spent an evening in Amsterdam, you know, a night out on the town with mostly Autumn, and that's when I met Troy Donnickley, who was playing pipes and flutes for them. I remember he performed all these cool magic tricks.
The Queen of Spades, watch, 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 watch. Queen of Spades and the King of Clubs, again, with just a pass. And you really genuinely do just pass the card. And it changes.
He's like this amazing musician. It's scary. But anyway, that night we promised to guest on each other's albums. So some months ago I reminded him of our agreement and I asked him to play some Julian pipes and low flutes on this album. Unfortunately, he didn't have the time in his busy schedule to come over to my studio. But he recorded all these incredible parts on his own and sent them to me. So thanks again, mate. You did an amazing job. It's no secret that my two favorite keyboard players of all time are Keith Emerson and Rick Wakeman. And I've always wanted to work with him. And finally, this time, I got them both to play on my album. I love Keith Emerson's stuff because of these huge impressive sounds and mainly on the Hammond and on the mighty modular Moog, of course. And I specifically asked him to play a solo on the modular Moog in the style of the legendary Lucky Man solo, and I got it. Rick Wakeman, for me, is the most complete player, keyboard player ever. You know, he plays very, very tight and fluent and beautiful, catchy melodies. As a little kid, Rick, I grew up listening to his solo albums, like, and I'm gonna show them to you. I don't know if I'm allowed to, but I will anyway. Like Six Wives, Henry VIII, and Journey to the Center of the Earth. Prized possessions, these. Also, his piano playing is on classics like Cat Stevens' Morning Has Broken, and Bowie's Live on Mars. It's just excellent. So. It's such a huge honor that he also played some piano on my album and some solos on the Mini Moog, and yeah, dreams are coming true. Now, I've already got my two heroes, Keith Emerson and Rick Wakeman, on keyboards on this album, but the icing on the cake is a brilliant solo by the great Jordan Rudess. And I think everyone agrees with me when I say that he's definitely one of the best keyboard players in the prog and metal world around at the moment. And I think he definitely proved this with this virtuoso solo. My favorite lineup of Genesis, and I'm sure many people will agree with me, is definitely the one with Steve Hackett on guitar, with, of course, the mighty Selling England by the Pound as the absolute highlight, undisputed. And I also love Steve's solo albums, you know, they're very adventurous and very eclectic. I love that. So I just had to have one of Steve's distinctive solos on my album. And I especially wrote a part for him. And luckily he agreed to do it immediately. So thanks, Steve. You know where to find me if I can ever return the favor. My good friend Wilmer Waarbroek, whom you might recognize from the wonderful backing vocals he did on my recent solo album Lost in a New Reel, some promotion here. He sang all the guide vocals for this album, which basically means that I sent a version of the songs with his vocals on it to all the singers, so they know what to sing and they can hear all the melodies in advance.
I'm reaching out to you, can you help me, son? I'm so close to the answer, but I need your brilliant mind.
And Wilmer is an amazing talent. It's always great fun working with him. And he's really fast. I think we recorded all his guide vocals in just 4 afternoons, you know, of all 7 singers.
Keep it between you and me. They would never understand. Let's both agree that no one needs to know.
Was that all right?
Maybe you can even hear it, you know. I think his guide vocals are floating around somewhere on YouTube, so I'd say check it out, because it's worth checking out.
High five?
Yeah.
On the last Aerion album, 01, I had no less than 17 singers, and although I really like that album, this may have been like slightly over the top, even for me. So It even meant that I had to put singers on parts that were meant to be instrumental. And also I didn't have enough space to show off the talents of the all the individual singers. So this time I only chose 7 singers. So yeah, that would give me more space to really show off what they can do.
Yay!
I first heard Christina Scabbia, Christina without the H, she asked me to tell you. In the Lacuna Coil track, To Myself I Turned, and I really, really like that track. So I visited a festival, I think it was some time ago, where she played with Lacuna Coil, and really liked her live performance as well. It was very powerful and she had great charisma on stage. So I met her backstage and I asked her if she was interested to guest on The Human Equation. So That's when it was.
I definitely say, yeah, we gotta do something together. We gotta work together. But then, for like multiple reasons, because of a deadline or a lack of time, it didn't happen back then.
This time, I had the perfect part for her, and I contacted her, and she said yes right away.
Can't you see that I need you right here? And what about a boy? I think he's got something to give. What secrets lie beyond these hollow eyes? High five! When I got the vocal line example, in my mail, I was like, I'm never gonna be able to do that. And that was another challenge. I was like, no, you know what? I'm gonna do it. You know, I'll do my best. I'll go there and try to do it. And in the end, I did it.
Her music is very, very different from my music. And I really like the fact that she's open to do different things.
I share your sorrow, but we're not to blame. As hard as always been a mystery. We'll never fathom, we'll never understand. Did he ever need us where we are real? Or mere reflections in a mirror of dreams? And I feel like I can fly.
Oh, you can fly. Bella. I also found that she's very talented, she's very versatile, and very, very emotional singer. Very musical, easy to work with. We had a lot of fun.
High five. I immediately said yes because I love challenges, and I was like, this is going to be a way for me to prove to myself that I can also do different things. So it was really important for me as a singer. Rob was really, really happy to do it, and I'm happy of what I did.
I know she loves to be complimented on her vocal abilities. Well, here it is, Christina. You're a great singer, and you're a great person as well.
Grandioso.
Mille grazie.
Ready, Eddie?
Yeah. Will we ever understand this complex genius, this visionary thinker? Will we ever get this close again, uniting the forces of our universe?
Some years ago, Inside Out gave me a Spiritual Beggars album, and it was a track called No One Heard, and I was blown away. I love that track. It's easily in my top 10 ever, without exaggerating. I mainly like it because of the huge voice of their singer JB, or Jub, as we like to call him.
His mind took flight, and his eyes have lost their light. All we have to go on is a note. They changed the world last night, working together side by side. His father is the only one who knows.
I already knew back then that I had to have that voice. You know, when I want something, I have to get it. I want it on Aerion. So I asked him back then, I think it was for 01.
The thing was that we had a new record label, and they were, you know, we were going to really put a lot of time into the new Grand Magus album, Hammer on the North.
Unfortunately, his record company told me no.
I wasn't able. I wasn't able to do it back then.
But a bit later, I got a mail from him saying that he realized I was in this Dutch metal band called Bodine.
When I started talking to Arjan, I realized that he was responsible for one of my favorite metal tracks ever, called Black Star Rising.
Apparently he was a huge fan. He was like, oh, Black Star Rising, that's like an amazing song.
I've listened to that song so many times that I was really intrigued about the, you know, the possibility to work with him.
I want the vibrato and perspective.
Okay, more.
Yeah, more.
More.
Deeper.
It's time to put things in perspective. Find your way again.
That's the one. If you don't like it, I won't use it.
No, it's cool. It's a bit Tom Jones, but
I like Tom Jones.
Yeah, so do I. So.
I didn't give up, and I asked him again for this album, and again he said no. So luckily, I got to talk to him on the phone, and I managed to convince him with my natural charms.
I talked to him on the phone, and somehow things didn't go as planned for me. So I guess he did something. I don't know what.
Maybe my Jedi mind tricks really do work. So I convinced him, and he said yes. And I'm so happy about that, because you know there are plenty of singers with high voices, but it's really hard to find a singer with like a deep full voice.
You can count on me. I'm glad to have such a mind to teach.
And since I want a lot of variation in voices on Arion, I'm really glad that this worked out.
Life doesn't have to be a mystery.
I like an early life. See if there's space.
I had a lot of fun. It was definitely a challenge, you know. This is something completely different from what I normally do, but I really enjoyed it and I learned a lot.
Oh, 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 oh. 5 years ago, I think it was, a journalist at my request passed my email address on to Marco Hietala.
Marco Hietala, that's me.
I know I pronounce it right this time.
My friend had given me the Universal Migrator double CD. I had to listen to it and liked it a lot, especially the prog side and all that. And he said that he's got an email to Arion and said that he might be interested in contacting me.
Marco emailed me back and he said he liked my stuff and he would love to work together one day.
We've sent some emails now and then afterwards, and now this whole thing then just happened.
Don't you believe it? Don't be a fool. Manipulate you is all he wants to do. He will deceive you. You're being used. Don't let him play you. All he wants to do, he wants to be with you. Whoa.
I really like his voice. It's very powerful, it's very versatile, and he can put a lot of emotion and acting in his performance, which was very important on this album.
Let's make a deal. I'll get you what you need. You know, I am a brilliant chemist. I can duplicate your drug. But my offer has a price. If you want a new supply, you'll have to help me.
We've been able to use quite a lot of different signs. Use the low, use the soft, use the hard, use the high, and all that. And that is a good thing because, well, yeah, in a lot of ways, I am a prisoner. I'm in the box with the bands that I'm usually with. This time around, we've been able to use the whole scale of things, which is really nice to me. I like that thing.
He was the first singer I recorded, and it was really an emotional moment for me to hear the story come alive, you know, with this amazing performance.
If he's as brilliant as they say, how will I be noticed? Now I'm not so special anymore. And I'm not sure why I'm afraid. No, he won't beat me. Not without a fight. No!
That no was good. Okay. We seem to agree pretty much on how to do certain things and when to go low, when to go high, what kind of melodies, what is the necessary, you know, amount of acting. Yeah, so far it's been really easy, and we've been agreeing with a lot of things, when to do things again and when we're satisfied with things and all that.
I love the second half, so just keep the first half.
Yep.
And try to get a little vibrato in the thought.
Thought.
Oh no, I always thought that we should be together.
Also, apart from being a really, really nice guy, he also turned out to be a very musical, intelligent guy. And he really deserves all the success he's having right now with Nightwish and Tarot, definitely.
Yeah, let's do high five. Let's do high five. Let's do. Yeah.
We got it!
You ever notice how singers do this when they sing? Why do we all do this? But if I went, say it, listen to it.
I read a review of an Australian band called Toe Hider, and supposedly they sound a bit like early Queen. You know, when I read that, it's like, okay, I gotta hear this. So I looked up Toe Hider on YouTube, and I saw this clip of one of their tracks, and yeah, I was impressed straight away. And somehow, well, you know how it goes on YouTube, you know, that video led me to another guy named Michael Mills, who was doing a cover of Thick as a Brick of Jethro Tull, I think on an upside down bouzouki or something. And I watched that too, and I was like, oh, this guy's great. And I left a comment of how great I thought it was.
There was a message in my Facebook inbox saying that he'd read a review of my stuff in a Dutch magazine and was keen to check out some more.
I didn't know, but it turned out that this Michael Mills guy was actually the leader of Toe Hider. So that was too much of a coincidence.
And then he said, would you be interested in singing on my next album? And it sort of blew my mind a lot, actually. It was just amazing to be invited. And but at that point he wasn't sure if it was going to be an Arion album or not. And then he said it will probably be an Arion album, and then I was like, holy crap, you know. So yeah, it blew my mind. My first initial response, short answer, it blew my mind.
I think this guy is an absolute genius, and to tell you the truth, I was actually nervous meeting and recording him. I was like, oh my God, this genius is gonna come here and he's gonna find out what a dork I am, you know. And also on YouTube, I saw these clips of him, and he was like this really eccentric dude. And you gotta check out his videos, and then you will see exactly what I mean.
Dear Odin, dear the Lords of Metal, please grant me the skill of holding a note for 40 seconds. 40 seconds. I'm not going to be able to do it. Oh, I could do it in the car.
So I had no idea what to expect, you know, what kind of weird guy is this going to be? But as it turned out, he's this amazingly nice guy, very considerate, even a bit shy, and didn't expect that at all.
The choice is clear. I don't need to be convinced. Denying him this chance just isn't right.
What a musician, and what a singer, and his range is just scary. He sings from low C all the way up to the highest B.
He wants me to sing it for him, but there's no way. No, I already lost my voice. Yeah, that's a good note. But don't do anything after that. Just stop at the da-da-da-da. Don't try this at home.
I can only do this once. I'm gonna die after this. I'll be dead.
Okay?
Yeah.
Now we will fulfill our fate!
He'd make me sing the same thing 5, 6, 10 times. We had it in the first take, so extreme perfectionist. No, I'm just joking. He's great. If something's great, he tells me it's great. If it's not so great, he tells me it's not so good.
He's also a very emotional singer, you know. He really became the part he had to sing.
Keep it between you and me. Oh, that would never understand. Let's both agree that no one needs to know.
So in short, well, a bit too late for in short, but this was a big success. And I'm sure this guy will be huge when people discover his genius. Mike, Thor is proud, and so am I.
High five! High five!
Yeah!
Come on!
Yeah!
Good job. Or at the fall of day, he took his life.
That works, eh?
Mm-hmm.
I needed a female singer for the part of the girl. That makes sense, Lucas. Yeah, glad you explained to us that you need a female.
It's a girl, obviously.
So someone sent me a mail with about 40 links, I think it was, to various female fronted bands. And I didn't really hear what I was looking for. And then I heard this band called Ancient Bards, and I thought, like, whoa. I think this singer, Sarah Squadrani, I think she's amazing.
This can't be true. Now who's being used? Don't let it end this way. It hurts me to tell you. You're gonna have to choose what you really wanna do.
Great vibrato, very important for me always, like a nice deep vibrato. So I got in touch with her via Facebook.
It came up almost as a shock. Like, does he really want me?
I asked her, can you please sing a little part of one of my songs for me, so I can really hear your voice, you know, and the way you sound on my music.
I don't have anything to record, just my phone. And he said, oh, it's all right, you know.
5 minutes later, she sent it back to me, and she recorded it, I think, on her cell phone or something. And needless to say, I got the obligatory goosebumps.
I don't know, he says something like he had goosebumps all over. And it was always so flattering.
Who's she? Come find Sarah. Hi.
And she came to my studio, and she was exactly as good as I thought she would be when I recorded her here.
You haven't been told. That was his mother on the phone. There was a tragedy last night. His father can't have been here. It had to be a ghostly dream. For at the fall of day, he took his life. It's always a tense moment. You have to do what you know you can do, but every time it's like you're, can I do it?
I saw her interview, and I know that she's a bit concerned about how people will respond to her being on this album.
I hope they like, of course, the whole album, and they're not ashamed that I'm in it, and I'm not as I'm not a big name in the music, but I try to do my best, and I hope they appreciate it.
Sarah, I can assure you, people will love you and your voice.
Whoa!
Yeah.
I bought the King Crimson album Starless and Bible Black back in 74, it must have been. I was 14. And I mainly bought it because of the great voice of John Wetton. And later on, the UK song Rendezvous 602 with John singing became one of my absolute favorite tracks. Again, you know, because of these beautiful, deep vocals. So I thought he'd be perfect for the role of the psychiatrist on this album.
Here we are at Liskin Park Studio. We're working on Ian Dickerson's album, and it's going really well. It went fantastically well.
It'd be great if you could do that album.
Do you feel it?
Could even double that one.
Yeah. Do you feel detached?
Is that the last line a bit too kind of over the top?
No, it's never over the top. It's never over the top. Right. I like over the top.
I've never met Ian before, but we get on really well.
No, it's hard.
It's hard to find the words indeed, because you got the wrong words.
Do you feel anything at all?
Love the little vibrato there at the end of all.
I contacted his manager, Daniel Earnshaw, who happened to be a big fan of my solo album. And he arranged everything. He arranged for me to record John in a studio in the UK. So thanks again, Daniel. And I'm really honored and proud to have John's distinctive voice on my album.
The side effects could include extreme delusions.
Yeah, got it.
So, yeah, it went great. I really enjoyed it. And I can't wait for it to be on the CD.
Here we go. Yes. Very cool.
I get many messages of fans every day suggesting me singers. But for years, people have been telling me to check out Tommy Karavik. I hope I pronounced that right. Sorry, Tommy, if it's wrong.
Hi, guys. I'm Tommy Karavik.
Karavik.
Karavik. Karavik from Camelot and Seventh Wonder.
He sang in Seventh Wonder at the time. And when he joined Camelot, and I kept reading all these amazing reviews about him in all the magazines and on the internet, I thought, let's check this guy out, you know, and what are they raving about? And yes, I was impressed. So I contacted him via Facebook, and he was interested immediately.
I was super happy, really happy, because that's one of the biggest things, actually, at least you can do, like to be asked to join like an all-star project or whatever. And also that it was him, because I also already listened to some of his albums and I really enjoyed it. So the first thing was, of course, sheer happiness.
Future I can build. Give me a role that I can fulfill. I know I've got something to give.
He turned out to be the perfect choice for the role of the prodigy, because I think you could say that he's somewhat of a prodigy himself. His natural talent and technique are just scary, you know. I think he's really up there with the likes of Russell Allen. And he's also very dedicated and a very nice guy as well. So, hey, what more do you want?
Dear friend, my work here is done. Science has evolved. As the sun set on Father and Son, the mystery was solved. I'm broken, I'm falling apart, slowly fading away. I'm sorry, I took it all too far. Thank you for your faith.
Hey people, it's been a couple of incredible days here together with Arjen. But I have to go home, but before I do, I really need to show a trick that me and the dog practiced these couple of days. So.
Come here, come here. High five, high five.
You see?
You're such a cute little guy.
Oh, poor Hoshi.
Oh, sorry.
He killed me with kindness. He's a really giant. I mean, it's really tall. You can, but he's not intimidating. He's extremely kind.
The first thing I kind of realized was that he's super nice. It was just instantly so comfortable, so accommodating.
I came here. I had no expectations whatsoever, so I didn't really knew what to expect. But experience in the studio was great.
He was really supportive, and we had a lot of fun doing the stuff. Even though it was hard, you know.
His kind is not afraid to ask you to do the things the way he wants. He's also willing to accept your kind, your point of view, and that's very good.
It's been very relaxing to do this thing, because he's ultimately responsible for what his album is going to be, and what he likes and what he doesn't like. I can insert those little things and ideas which I like to do, but in the final result, I can pretty much be laid back and trust Arjen's vision about how he wants the things to be.
I have to take a step back sometimes and think, that's pretty special that I'm part of something that so many people revere, worship almost, and I'm just part of that, you know. Okay, those stupid goosebumps here.
It turned out really cool, and Arjen is great to work with, and super nice guy and talented, so I guess you'll hear. The end result was really cool.
His work for me just keeps getting better and better. So I'm really looking forward to hearing this theory of everything as an entire work, because I haven't heard it like that yet.
I can't wait to hear the final result and to hear how different voices of people that never met before can come together and create something amazing and epic as it's going to be. So I'm really, really, really excited, and you should be excited too.
And then there's someone I would really like to thank. It's someone without whom, you know, this would not have been possible. Really, it would have been a complete disaster without her.
Yeah, Suje. Yeah, you know, shooting. Without you, this would not have been possible.
Now she's licking her bits.
What's the middle finger behind you? My friend Jeroen has played wind instruments. That's weird. Again. My friend Jeroen has played wind instruments. Are you Dutch or what?
It's from my favorite 70s band.
Another studio. In this case, we again. Finally been able to work with one of my biggest musical heroes, the amazing Keys. Amazing. The amazing. Yeah, two.
It's time to let go. My spirit is crushed, forsaken and cold. I'm leaving you. No tears left to cry. You'll never change. I made up my mind. This is goodbye.
Yeah! I'm not sure why I'm afraid. No, he won't beat me, not without a fight. No! One day I'll show them I am the genius. You believe it, don't be a fool. Manipulate you is all he wants to do. He will deceive you. You're being used. Don't let him play you. All he wants to do, he wants to be with you.
I'm down here on my knees, feeling the weight of shame. How could I have done this to you, my son?
Of things.